Greetings! Now, radium was discovered in 1898 by Marie and Pierre Curie, which discovery was released to the public in 1902. But all they really know about radium was that it was extremely radioactive, glowed in the dark, and constantly gave off this light warmth. After Marie and Pierre discovered that radium could destroy human tissue, it was immediately put to work destroying cancerous tumors, of which it did a great job. Because of this supposed life-saving nature, radium was viewed as this wondrous medical marvel and championed as history's great find. Without bothering to find out if radium had any detrimental effects, it was assumed that radium was incredibly healthy. The reasoning was, if it could destroy cancer cells, it could surely solve anything. It was the new wonder element. Doctors and anyone else who sold anything medical used it as a cure-all. Any kind of affliction you can think of had some kind of radium product to fix that ailment. There were radium wound dressings, radium water, radium clinics, and radium spas. It was everywhere, particularly in the United States. It seemed like a beacon of light, literally, to anyone who was suffering. But what they didn't realize was that radium was actually slowly killing people from the inside out. In April 1917, the USA joined World War I. All the men were sent to war, and the girls were left at home to help with the war effort however they could. Working class females across America flocked to all the factories, trying to get any job available. But there was one particular job that everyone wanted, dial painting, since it paid three times average factory wage. Dial painting wasn't a salary job. You were paid per watch face that you painted. So the quicker you were, the better you got paid. You were working with one of the most valuable materials on earth at this point. Radium-centered businesses began popping up all across America, mostly on the East Coast, which was closer to the war effort. I will focus particularly on one of these factories, the Radium Luminous Materials Corporation in Newark, New Jersey. The girls that worked there painstakingly painted luminous numbers on tiny watch dials. They needed to be painted with radium because the radium would make it glow in the dark for military use so that soldiers could see them at night, but not as bright as a light bulb, which would allow them to be seen by enemy soldiers. Each girl was required to mix her own paint. They would dab a radium powder, radium mixed with zinc sulfide, which would give this amazing glow. The paint was called undark paint, which glowed with greenish-white luminosity. Due to the tiny size of the dial numbers, the girls needed really slim paintbrushes. As the girls worked, the paintbrush hairs would inevitably spread, and they could not function properly. And so they used a technique called lip pointing, where they would wet the bristles in their mouth to put the hairs back together. Each time they did this, they would swallow a minuscule amount of radium powder. The girls were told it was completely safe to do so. They would sometimes question their supervisors about it, and each time were told it was perfectly healthy, probably even good for you. But the bosses and people higher up in the factory knew otherwise. They knew that radium could have detrimental effects and was known to be hazardous. Other employees were only allowed to handle radium with tongs, protective lead aprons, goggles, and such like. The company knew that radium was bad for people, as the company founder needed part of his finger amputated to get the radium out, but they still let the girls lip point. Some even told the girls that the radium would make them more beautiful and make their cheeks glow. Some of these girls did literally have this glowed to them as they were regularly covered in radium powder. But what they didn't know is that this radium was concurrently eating their bones from the inside and or growing the beginning stages of tumors that would become the size of basketballs. Some girls even wore their evening dresses to work if they knew they were going out to dance that night because they would leave glowing, literally. It was 1922 when the first girl started showing signs of illness. Another colleague named Molly had to quit her job because she became so ill. She had no idea what was causing it. It all started when she had an aching tooth, and so Molly went to the dentist, expecting them just to remove the tooth and that's it. They pull the tooth out, but the ache won't stop. The wound in her gum refuses to heal. It's an open abscess in her mouth. Then the next tooth starts hurting. And then the next. Molly's dentist pulls out every single tooth that's causing an issue. Yet it just gets worse. Her mouth was constantly seeping with pus from abscesses and ulcers, causing her to have constant horrific breath, which couldn't be stopped. And her legs, arms, and everything else hurt besides. By May 1922, Molly had lost most of her teeth. One day, she went to the dentist again. While the dentist went into her mouth to pull another tooth, her entire jaw crumbled in his hand. He literally removed part of her jaw by lifting it out of her mouth without effort. Still, nobody knew what was wrong with her. By this point, other factory workers had also acquired these symptoms. Some of them were having aching jaws. Some were having aching limbs. Others couldn't get out of bed in the morning since it hurt so much. But this was years after they first started working at the factory. On September 12, 1922, the infection spread to Molly's throat, where it ate through her jugular vein, and Molly literally choked to death on her own blood. She was just 24. Molly was the first of many girls to die from radium's effects. Across New Jersey, more and more girls were going to their doctors with similar symptoms, but each case was different enough to not link it to the last. Since people were making massive amounts of money off of radium, nobody wanted to question it. In December 1922, cases began to be reported, but reported as phosphorus poisoning. Finally, in 1924, it was proven that radium caused these horrific illnesses. Yet after authorities found that radium was the cause, management lied and said they constantly warned the girls about safety hazards. And once radium is in the body, it cannot be removed. It has a half-life of 1,600 years. A half-life is the time it takes for the concentration of any substance to decrease by half. Nothing known to science can neutralize radium, so tragedies continued. In 1925, Dr. Levin from that company got blackened lesions on his hands, then suddenly died at age 36 from pernicious anemia. An autopsy proved that he was inundated with radium. Other young women were bedridden in hospitals with hollowed out bones and covered in black and blue spots. In the 1930s, a woman named Catherine Wolf Donahue developed a grapefruit-sized tumor on her hip, and her jaw began to fall apart. She had worked at a dial painting factory in Ottawa, Illinois. Eventually, over 14,000 people would die in factories in America every single year. Radium's discoverer, Marie Curie, herself had destroyed her health and eyesight from radioactive elements, causing her to die prematurely in a sanatorium. Her co-discoverer, husband Pierre, died prematurely after slipping and falling under a wagon wheel, which crushed his skull. What an end to the so-called miracle of science.